Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on Newsradio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors Key, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And by the way, they would have sold, 1,000 Fords this year at Sunbury Motors? Great product, even better dealership. And today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Purdy's have served this valley for decades. Whether it's auto, home, life, or business, finding their customers, their clients, the best insurance that they're covered, the absolute best price, because budget's important. And if something were to happen, Purdy Insurance goes to work for you immediately with no let-up. It's Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. All right, play-by-play call of the day. Here it is. It's Greg Zuerlein. 57 yards in overtime.
And they're just getting started as Zuerlein sets up for a 57-yard try to win the NFC Championship game. The hold is down. The kick clears the line. And Greg Zuerlein sends the Rams to the Super Bowl! L.A. will play for the Lombardi! Greg Zuerlein from 48 in regulation and 57 in overtime. 26-23. It's over. And the Superdome is silent.
75,000 did go silent, but the eight people in that booth were jumping up and down. You can hear that. Well, there's a lot to talk about with each of these games. The fact is the Rams kept the Saints out of the end zone twice in the first quarter. That was huge. And they settled for field goals. That was huge. So the Saints had the inability to finish, including the, gee, we have Drew Brees, but we're going to run Wildcat with Taysom Hill. No, you don't do that. Okay? No. I mean, the Rams knew it was coming. He was standing there. They knew he was coming. I mean, when Brees leaves the field, what are you thinking? That didn't make any sense. I mean, don't outthink yourself. Don't get yourself so clever you outthink yourself. McVay makes a great call. And by the way, if they failed, I would have said it was a great call on the fake punt. Sometimes you've got to do something. You've got to do something sometimes that the other guy doesn't expect along the way, and you've got to do it at a point where, hey, look, if it fails here, we're gonna lose anyway, because right now we're doing nothing. Our only chance to really get this thing going again is to somehow make this play. So they made it. They got great pressure on Brees in overtime for the interception, but a lot of this is going to come down to the blown call on the pass interference. As I've said once, I've said it many, many times, I do not complain about officials when they're making tough calls. Never. My problem has always been, when it comes to officials, quite simple. When you are missing the easy calls, you have a problem. When you are missing the easy calls, or you are guessing on calls. Now let's go back to the Brady roughing the passer penalty. Okay? I don't care what he says. That's a total guess. The helmet did not budge, didn't move, didn't do anything. He didn't hit the face mask, didn't hit the helmet, did nothing. He belted him in the shoulder pad. I'm sorry, last time I checked, when a guy's throwing the ball, you can belt him to the ground. Belting him in the shoulder pad does nothing. I mean, in fact, the only quarterback in that game that got hit in the helmet was Patrick Mahomes. Oh, and guess what? There was no call. And he got hit right in the chops. So that's always been my problem with officiating. If you're missing the easy calls, you have a problem. If you are guessing at a call, you're also wrong. You only can call what you actually see. You have to actually see a penalty to call it. If you don't actually see the penalty and you're guessing at it, that is not right either. And that's where they've got to somehow drum into these guys, only call what you see. Now, you may have two officials of the Saints game saying, we didn't see the pass interference, but that's hard to believe. Doesn't mean that there were not mistakes made. As I pointed out at the start of the show, Andy Reid deferring, okay, putting Tom Brady on the field and keeping Patrick Mahomes on the bench to start the game. He put, of the 8 units in the playoffs remaining, there are 8 that played yesterday, 8 units, offense, defense. The Chiefs' defense was the worst of the 8 units at 31 in the NFL. I want them on the field as little as possible. I want Patrick Mahomes on the field as often as possible. Thus, if I win the coin toss, I want the ball in his hands. I think that was a mistake that hung over the game for a long time because Kansas City was playing from behind all day. Doesn't mean that Patrick Mahomes and the offense wouldn't have gone 3 and out, but you worked on your script. You've got this gunslinger quarterback that's the most exciting thing to come into this league in years. All right, I want to see him out there with the ball making plays. He goes, they go 3 and out, they go 3 and out. Okay, I got it. But football's a game of possessions. I want Patrick Mahomes to have more possessions. I want Tom Brady to have fewer. I take the ball. All right, let's bring in Matt Leon from KYW in Philadelphia. Matt, welcome. Great to have you with us on the show today.
Glad to be with you.
Okay, let's. I want. Can I get to something quickly here? Penn wins the Big Five.
Yeah, they get a piece of it. They can win it outright if they beat St. Joe's next week. But just having a piece of it, that's a big deal.
Look. I think Steve Donahue is a marvelous coach. I always have. The Boston College made a huge mistake in terms of how things turned out there. But that's just my opinion on it. When you sit there and you look at the job he's done with them to get their program back on track, what have been your thoughts?
Well, he gets a phenomenal. I think number one, I mean, X and O's aside, he's obviously brilliant at that. But the thing Steve does, and I can tell you, you know, as somebody who's, you know, travels with the team and stuff like that, he gets the kids to buy in, and he gets the kids to understand their roles and what's expected of them. Because I think one of the most impressive things is, you know, he's had kids who, when he took over the program, were starters or who played a lot of basketball. And then things started to change as he brought in guys or he put his philosophies in. And some of those kids didn't play nearly as much, if at all. You know, a lot of DNP CDs. But those kids stuck with the program. And I look at a kid last year like Sam Jones, who was a three-point specialist, who would go, you know, several games not playing. And then a certain matchup would come up. Steve would call his number. He'd go in there and he'd hit 5 threes. And he'd be engaged and be ready to go. This year, the kid is Jake Silpe, who came in as a pretty highly regarded prospect, played a lot as a freshman. Yep. All his time dwindled the next couple of years. But this year, because of some injuries and situations, he has been pointed to as a sometime starter, first guy off the bench, and he's been magnificent. And he is a big reason why they've been able to pull off some of these wins that they've been able to pull off. So I think aside from the obvious job he can do recruiting in the Ivy League and the X's and O's, he does a tremendous job of getting and maintaining buy-in from all the kids in the program.
Now let's go to the next part. The Baseball Hall of Fame class is going to be announced. Roy Halladay, the late Roy Halladay, is there. And, for example, I think ESPN polled 9 of its baseball people how they're going to vote. All 9 had Roy Halladay on there. If you were in the room and had a chance to speak on behalf of Roy Halladay, what would you say?
I would say he was kind of the last of his kind as far as a guy that you could count on. I mean, when you really think about it, who was the last pitcher that you were surprised almost when they didn't go the distance? and he was the last guy kind of that was like that. I mean, the career numbers, I think the adversity he had early in his career when he actually was sent down to the minors,
right,
to kind of almost reinvent himself, and just just one of the great competitors of all time. And then you think about, you know, he got the chance at the postseason. All he did was throw a no-hitter in his first playoff game with the Phillies. I think it's a no-brainer. I think when you look at his numbers, his competitiveness, and his ability to pitch nine innings, start in and start out, really kind of, like I said, the last of that kind of pitcher, I think, that you know, you're able to kind of anchor a rotation around. So I would be stunned if he's not on the list.
I want to ask you quickly about Machado and Harper. Yes, they both visited the Phillies. In reality, and look, nobody's signed anything yet with anybody. How serious do you think the Phillies are about either one of these guys, and is there one you think they're more serious about than the other?
I think they're serious about both. I honestly have kind of thought that the longer this thing drags out, the better it is for them. Because you've really got to take a grain of salt. There are so many reports with so many different agendas coming from so many different directions, and you don't know who's at stake in what report, stuff like that. But I think that the longer they're in here, I think the Phillies have the ability to overpay and the ability to do that. I think of the two, it kind of sounds like Machado is, in a perfect world, they're one, with Harper being 1A. Once that's not based on anything but, you know, some reports and reading some tea leaves, stuff like that. But I will genuinely be surprised if they don't walk away with one of those two guys coming out of this offseason. I'm frankly tired of hearing about it. You're really just to the point where you just want them to sign somewhere so we can all move on. But I think when it's all said and done, one of them will be in the Phillies lineup.
It's the second straight year, though, that it's taken a long time to sign people, to the point where Chris Bryant came out, said something about it, because eventually he's going to be a free agent. And I think what everyone thought was going to be the $200 million guy, $250 million guy last year, it was supposed to be J.D. Martinez to get half of that, and then, in a relative sense, earned every dime last season. What are you hearing from anybody about, maybe not collusion, but the lack of traction these guys are getting?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I mean, if I'm reading correctly, like Andrew McCutchen, who the Phillies signed early in the offseason, is like the only position player to like get multiple years and top $50 million or something like that. I don't know exactly what that deal, I mean, it's a nice signing for the Phillies, but I don't think anybody looked at that as a marquee contract. But right now, when you look at position players, it's kind of a high watermark. You know, whether it is quote unquote collusion, whether it's course correction, whether it's just guys being cheap, which, you know, is possible. There is definitely seems to have been a sea change with regards to people throwing money at guys like we had seen years before.
Because essentially the salary cap, and there's no cap in baseball, but look, it's $206 million. If you go over that, now you're paying the luxury tax. Okay, so there's kind of a threshold. Is there any hesitation, do you think, in pouring 10 to 20% into one person?
I don't think with the Phillies. I think they're comfortable with that because I think they're John Middleton, the lead owner, I think, has been anxious to get the Phillies back as a, you know, kind of the marquee team in the city as much as baseball can be. And I think he would be more than willing to write that check. I mean, he was the guy early in the offseason who talked about throwing stupid money around. So I don't think they're worried that much. I mean, obviously any business is worried about a tax like that, but I don't think that is something that would not make or break any kind of decision-making when it came to signing guys.
Hey, Matt, thanks so much. Appreciate it.
Always my pleasure.
That's Matt Leon, KYW in Philadelphia. 25 years ago today, Robert Kraft purchased the New England Patriots. 50 years ago today, after Joe Paterno
told Art Rooney, nah, I want to stay at Penn State. I don't want the job. The Steelers hired their fourth coach in 6 years, Chuck Knoll. Fourth coach in 6 years. Since this day, the Steelers have had three. Knoll, Cowher, Mike Tomlin. Michael McCambridge wrote the really good biography on Chuck Knoll. It's called, entitled Chuck Knoll, His Life's Work. Very well thought out by Michael McCambridge. Hopefully you've had a chance to read it. At his introductory press conference, Knoll was asked how it felt to come to a city of losers. Knoll's response, a city of losers? That's a lot of nonsense. Geography has nothing to do with winning. Winning is a product of work and attitude. Back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance.
Sunburn Motors is bringing in the new year with a lofty goal. Sell 1,000 new Fords in 2019. You heard right, 1,000 new Fords. SMC knows they can achieve this lofty goal, and here's why. Sunbury Motors Ford has 2019 Ford Fiestas starting at $12,820. That's a new car for under $13,000. Browse Central Pennsylvania's largest selection of four-wheel drive vehicles. Pick from 68 Ford Escapes, and they're slashed to as low as $17,820. SMC has all remaining 2018 Ford Explorers reduced by $8,000, starting at $33,985. Sunbury Motors has over 100 new Ford trucks with F-150s marked down up to $14,000 and Super Duties as much as $15,000. SMC's goal of selling 1,000 new Fords in 2019 will be your gain. Sunbury Motors in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, proudly serving all of Central Pennsylvania and the Susquehanna Valley for over a century.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
Well, yesterday certainly was a great day of football. Two overtime games, big plays, incredible plays. I mean, Goff made a couple of plays out of the pocket yesterday that I thought were phenomenal. Mahomes kept his team in the game with the phenomenal things he did. Brady is just not human. And New Orleans had several missed opportunities, and there's also controversy. The NFL got about everything out of yesterday they could get. Between excitement, important games, big-time moments, big-time plays, big-time players, big-time mistakes, and controversy. They have it all today. Everybody's talking about it. And again, my point has always been on officiating. It's always been simple. When you're missing the easy calls, you have a problem. There's so many calls that are tight. They're 50-50. They're close. I got it. Could go either way. How often do you say, well, that one could go either way? Right. I got that. That's just one man's opinion as to what they see, the angle they see it, and so forth. But when you're missing the easy ones, you do have a problem. Pass interference play is an easy problem. Is an easy call. You have a problem. Okay, the hit on Brady's, you know, okay, on the roughing the passer, no offense. That's an easy no call. That's easy. You want to know why it's easy? Okay, watch the play. I don't care what angle you're looking at. Does not matter what angle you were looking at on the roughing the passer call. Okay? Brady's helmet doesn't move. Doesn't move. That means he didn't get hit. There was a no call on Brandon Cook's play, on a pass play where Goff made a beautiful pass. It set up a touchdown. They scored anyway. But on the play, Cook's helmet goes boom straight down. It's an obvious that it's face mask. Brady, you can tell, doesn't get hit in the helmet. You can just see, no matter what angle you are, if the helmet doesn't move, he's not roughed. You can't guess. When you're missing the easy calls or you're guessing, you've got a problem.
Another play I was thinking of from last night's game was that terrific catch that Chris Hogan caught in the second half. They're kind of going angled, different angle.
And they reviewed it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I'm talking about the unreviewable stuff.
Right.
Roughing the passer is not reviewable. Pass interference is not reviewable. When you are missing the easy calls, okay, or you're guessing, you have a problem. If you're guessing or assuming, you have a problem. If you're missing the easy call, you have a problem. That's the issue on both of those. Okay, on one of them, I don't care what, you know, he can sit right here. I look up and say, you're assuming and you're guessing. There is no way you saw him hit, that you actually saw what happened. There's no way. He could be sitting right here. I tell right to his face. They guessed and assumed because he saw the arm swing, and they guessed and assumed. That's not official. You can't do that. You have to see it. And conversely, on the pass interference. I mean, the other stuff's all reviewable. I thought, you know, the ball where the ball bounced on the punt and Edelman looked like he muffed it. To their credit, I think they got it right. The Rams, by the way, are the home team for the Super Bowl. They're going to wear their retro uniforms. The blue with the yellow. They're going retro. And in honor of that, Kevin Hur is going to wear a leisure suit. A bad kind of retro.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by our good friends at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. The Purdy's have served this valley for decades. Repeat customers, so many of them. Why? Because people have complete trust and faith in them. Auto, home, life, business insurance. Make sure you're covered. Okay? Best price. They look for it. They want to make sure that you don't get ripped off. If there's a claim, boy, do they ever go to work. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. They have many great products there, including Ford. They want to sell 1,000 of them this year, brand new ones. Believe me, Sunbury Motors, great dealership. Sales staff, top-notch. Service department, wow. Speaking of wow, what did you think of Tony Romo yesterday?
I think it was outstanding.
Everybody does.
I Mike Freeman, the writer for Bleacher Report, says Tony Romo is a sorcerer. I'll admit there's a couple times I'm saying, "Who do you think you are, Kreskin?" Yeah, he was just really dialed into that game last night. It was terrific.
Dialed in, enthusiastic, exciting to listen to, insightful. He had one of those incredible games. That's nothing to do with Troy Aikman. Troy Aikman's fine. But what Romo did was incredibly, incredibly spectacular yesterday. Look, and I've got the privilege of working with the guy that I work with, Jack Ham. Jack Ham is so good. You know what Tony Romo does and what Jack Ham does? You know what each of them do that is so, I think... Hey, never, never look at the audience and think they're dumb. Unless they give you a reason to. No, I'm just kidding. Never look at the audience and think they're dumb. Don't talk down to them. Okay, don't dumb the game down. The audience is smart. It's sophisticated. They want to hear high-level, intelligent commentary. They want to hear something insightful. They don't want you to be repeating what's on the replay.
I think there's a fine line, though, between that and overcomplicating it, right?
Yeah, but he just talks to people. And, you know, but a lot of people know about football, though, Sean. A lot of people do, because we've watched it over and over and over and over again. Same thing with basketball, same thing with football. You don't have to, I mean, you don't need Peter Puck, okay? Remember when the NHL was trying to teach Americans about hockey? They brought in Peter Puck. Of course, I watched hockey growing up, just thinking, oh, what the heck is this stupid thing? I walked out of the room, I'm watching Peter Puck. Felt bad for Brian McFarlane having to stand there with Peter Puck and explain the game of hockey. If it goes all the way down, it's called icing. Oh, for goodness sakes, get me out of the room. Okay. Well, guys like Jack Ham and Dick Girardi on basketball and Tony Romo yesterday just tell the audience what's happening. They see certain things. Romo did a lot ahead of time. Right? Jack will do the same thing. Dick will do the same thing. If you listen to what they're saying, they'll kind of give you an indication of where something is about to go or where they should think about going. Well, Romo's doing the same thing yesterday. Finally lined up Gronk wide. They finally had him one-on-one wide late in the game. He's telling everybody that's where they're going to go. And not only that, he's having fun. He's enthusiastic. He's into what's going on. He's not boring. I just thought he was... I think he's always been exceptional. Thought he took it to another level yesterday. And everyone knows, you know, obviously, that's why I think Penn State fans have been so fortunate, that when they listen to a football game, they've got Jack Ham. And when they listen to a basketball game, they get Dick Girardi. Two guys that are high-level, high-end analysts, where the game's done and you feel like you learned about a little bit more about the game. Tony Romo did the same thing yesterday. It's impressive. Very impressive. You never know he's been doing this for 2 years. Like he's been doing it for 20. Not only that, but if you are going to face Tony Romo in a $50 Nassau, make sure you do have the 50 in your pocket. Because Tony can play. Whew. What a job he did. Yeah, and he's got the Super Bowl, too. That was some... I mean, I'll be honest with you. That was some performance yesterday. Wow. See, that's the difference of the ability to know the game, not talk down to the audience, and have the ability to explain the game another step further beyond the knowledge that the audience has, which is what he did. He was so well prepared. And he's into what's going on. I mean, he's having fun doing the game. If you can't have fun doing the game, don't do the game. You got to remember it's still a game.
That's why I show up here every day.
Staff meeting?
Well, yeah. It's Monday, right. But but I'm armed with a cup of coffee going into that, so.
I've got a few thoughts. Yes, he, very few.
He did, yes.
Yes, very few.
Right.
All right. So,
so a topic we started to kick around last year, late spring into summer, was sports betting.
Yes.
And get this, New Jersey, since the launch of sports betting, has reeled in $1 billion since last summer.
Okay.
So there's an outfit in New Jersey called PointsBet, and they're going to offer betting credits for customers who bet on the Saints game yesterday because of the PI, the blown PI call. It's a group called PointsBet. They say they're going to, well, they're going to refund wagers, where they're going to give credits. They're going to refund wagers on the spread and money line bets on the Saints. So, but they're going to go bonus bets and not cash payouts.
Yeah, I don't know. Now, it's going to be interesting. This will be the first Super Bowl since the ruling opening the door for states to have legalized sportsbook, of which now we have Nevada, Delaware, New Jersey. We now have two spots in Pennsylvania, Granville and at Rivers in Pittsburgh. And is there any other states? Does Mississippi have it right now? Surprised West Virginia doesn't have it yet. I thought they were going to beat Pennsylvania to the punch. It's going to be interesting to see how much money is put down in these states legally on the game, on the Super Bowl. It's the first Super Bowl we've had. And by the way, it's also the first time ever that the World Series and the Super Bowl have the same cities. Did you know that? Red Sox, Dodgers, Rams, Patriots. First time ever. Let's see here. Let's see. Legalized sports book. Legalized sports betting states. Just want to make sure who has it.
Yeah, we have fun going into every Super Bowl, all the prop bets you can have a blast with. It just makes you wonder right. How many of those in Vegas and beyond you'll be able to throw a couple of bucks down here in the next week or so.
Right. Only two states, legal land-based sports betting in the entire country, and they're in Nevada and Delaware. That's not true. Let's see.
Are you saying don't believe everything you read on the interweb?
Yeah, no kidding. You know why I
Blinders.
Don't.
That's true. That's right. Sleeping with my eye open.
There was actually one thing on there. It was a couple weeks ago, and you know I don't read that stuff. I don't really. You know what I mean? But one of my kids called me up, and they said, "Hey, Dad, can we ask you a question?" And I said, "Sure." Who pays you to do Penn State football and basketball? I said, Penn State does. I said, my check's from Penn State. They said, well, on the internet, they're saying you're paid by Learfield and you don't have to avoid talking about injuries and recruiting. I said, no, who wrote that? I said, this is one where I'm the authority on it. I said, where was this? And they told me what site it was on. I said, just let it alone.
Now, was it a website or a message board?
It was a message board.
No, well, that says it all. There you go.
Yeah, there was a message board about how I get paid. I'm like, I said, my W-2 says Penn State. I don't know. Maybe the message board knows more than I do. So if you're wondering why I don't know, I don't trust it. It's like, okay. Again, I didn't bother, but it's like when your kids are asking you, I said, where'd you get that from? They told me. I said, oh. Ended that conversation pretty fast. Oh.
And since you're on the line, how are the kids?
Yeah.
How's everybody doing? More importantly, how's everybody doing?
They're all doing well, yes. Yeah. Yeah, he was doing well, but I thought, you've got to be kidding me. Like, okay. I said, why? I stayed away from why do you go there?
Yeah.
But let's see. I know we have it in two places, right?
Well, let's see. Rivers Casino in Pittsburgh opened up before the Steelers-Pats game.
And Granville.
Granville, and I believe there was supposed to be a Parks casino.
Parks, I think, is supposed to get it, but I don't know if Parks has it yet. There was another hurdle I thought they had to clear.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was them or the casino at Valley Forge or is it Sugar Hill, one of those?
Well, I think Parks, because I've talked to Dick about this, I think Parks was close but wasn't there yet. Now, we know New Jersey does. In fact, when I was in Atlantic City for the NC State game, we went over to Bally's for dinner because Guy Fieri's is all over at Bally's, so we wanted to go in there and get a steak and whatever. Okay. And so we went through Sportsbook at one stage. And now, I don't know how much had been placed during the day. I don't know. I have no idea. Okay? But there was hardly anybody in there. There was a few college basketball games on, things like that. But there wasn't many people in there. We were surprised at how few people there were in there. But it's interesting how they
So I jumped on LegalSportsReport.com, and they have a list.
Okay.
Hollywood Casino at Penn National.
Yep.
Started in November. William Hill runs the sportbook at Hollywood. Rivers Casino, Pittsburgh. Sugar right. House Casino. I said Sugar Hill. I was thinking of Sugar Hill Gang yeah. Rapper's Delight. Okay. It's Sugar House Casino.
Right.
They followed Rivers same day last month. First sports betting option in Philly.
Right.
The current sport book is temporary. Will be upgraded this year. There's also, Parks Casino joined, looks like earlier this year. It's a temporary sportbook that's a combination of windows and self-service kiosks. Also, the South Philadelphia Turf Club, a betting shop that's located near the homes of all four major pro sports teams in Philly, and took its first wager, it said mid-January, maybe last week.
Okay. Well, here are the states that they have here. These are the ones that were, that have sports betting laws that are grandfathered. Oregon, Nevada, Montana, Delaware. As you know on this show, how many times have I mentioned that? Those four states have it. I think the one that got everybody was, what, Oregon and Montana do? Yeah. Oregon, Montana, Nevada, Delaware. Okay? Now, these are the states that have a legal regulated sports betting industry. They are now New Mexico, Mississippi, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York, Rhode Island. Bills have been introduced in these states. Not there yet, but they've been introduced in California, Louisiana, Oklahoma, Kansas, Missouri, Iowa, Illinois, Indiana, Kentucky, Ohio, Michigan, Connecticut, and Massachusetts, as well as South Carolina. So give me credit. Delaware launched June 5th. New Jersey launched June 14th. Mississippi, August 1st. West Virginia, August 30th. Pennsylvania, November 16th. Rhode Island, November 26th.
Looks like the next one in Pennsylvania is going to be Philadelphia later this week. There's a Harrah's that's going to be opening. They have a grand opening on Thursday later this week.
Is that at Parks?
Harrah's Philadelphia. It's owned by Caesars.
Okay.
It'll be in Delaware County.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see how much money is bet this year on the Super Bowl. As opposed to how much money was bet last year, because there's an easier way for people to do it now.
But the South Philadelphia Turf Club sounds like it's walking distance from Citizens Bank Park and the Link and down the sports complex.
Okay. Plus, at some point, you're going to get kiosks.
Yeah.
I mean, that's going to be the next part of this.
December marked the first full month of Pennsylvania sports betting. Rivers hauled in $5.5 million in Pittsburgh, Sugar House $5.53 million, and Hollywood down at Grantville just over $5
million. Wow.
Bettors put up more than $16 million in sports wagers in December, and the results is a hold of more than $2 million, a 12.4% hold. So very strong in December.
Very strong, and of course that's coinciding with football down the stretch. It's going to be interesting to see what the January report looks like. It's going to be interesting to see what the Super Bowl early February report looks like with these states having it. All right, we'll take a break. Back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Great to have you with us on the show. The amount bet on the Super Bowl because of legalized gambling in this country is going to be very interesting. So many people have easy avenues to doing it now. So the number that will be bet, especially on a coast-to-coast Super Bowl, is this not regionalized in any way between New England and Los Angeles? Wow. Tim Kirkchen is going to join us on the show Wednesday. Tony Knopp on Wednesday. Bob Buhner is going to be here Thursday. Neil Coulong tomorrow. And Al Riveron, the head of NFL fishing. No, I'm just kidding. No? Didn't get that one lined up, did we? No.
I've got a hit list, but he's not on it. So
didn't think so.
No, he's
okay.
Probably busy. So, but I could. Doesn't hurt to ask them.
Look, I thought I'd give it a shot. You know? Al, we thought we'd give it a shot. We left a message. I don't think Al's coming on the show or anybody's show anytime soon. You know, it's interesting. The NFL really has not publicly commented on what happened. They haven't said anything. I mean, they may have talked to Sean Payton about it, but they haven't talked to anybody else.
I thought that was kind of funny. There was a cry on social media last night. Roger Goodell needs to hold an impromptu press conference in Arrowhead Stadium and what's he going to say?
What's he supposed to say?
You know, it's not going to change the final scores.
We're going to pick up the game from that spot. Should be good.
Saints Look, Chiefs. I want Saints Chiefs next week. No Pro Bowl.
But that's the playoff bowl. My goodness, the Steelers used to play in that. They used to play in that thing at the Orange Bowl in Miami. Right? It was a disaster. The playoff bowl in the 60s. The Eagles even played in it once. They started Jack Concannon at quarterback.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.